A very good afternoon to one and all of you, and I really look forward to an absolutely gripping session where you get to know exactly what you want to know in exactly 6 minutes, dear speakers. And my expert panel has to also ensure that they keep the discussion only for 2 minutes, crisp to the point. And I do want my audience to gain as much as possible and remember ARC forever. So here we go on to our preferred practice guidelines. Expert panel, some of them have yet to join. Dr. Raj Narayan, Dr. Avinash Patanjay should be joining anytime. Dr. Bishwas, I think, may not be. Dr. Shobhit Chawla. Tenerson, did you call? Dr. Shobhit. Okay. Anyway, we have with us Dr. Malika Goel, and we are truly thankful to Dr. Pramod Bede for sitting here, and Dr. Kim, who has promised to give a lot of time to us. And with these three strong people, I'm sure we are heading ahead. Dr. Anand Rajaran is not to be with us because of some illness in the family. And we go on to our second speaker, Dr. Tenerson, who's going to tell you something which is very relevant to all of us. Post-op endophthalmitis management preferred practice guidelines. On to you, Dr. Tenerson.
Good afternoon, everyone. So I'll be discussing about the management of post-operative endophthalmitis. So as we all know that post-operative endophthalmitis is a dreadful and sight-threatening complication. So we should practice some guidelines for the management. So post-op, it could be fulminant or acute or chronic. So that depending upon the type of organism, we need to be make sure that the intravitreal antibiotic response is better for the particular organism. So once the patient has been diagnosed, we need to evaluate the patient, and particularly the history is very important regarding that surgery, and if there is any history of complication during surgery or if there is any contamination of eye drops. And best character visual acuity assessment is definitely should be checked before surgery. And ultrasound preoperatively, it's very important. And systemic comorbidity has to be taken care of. Consent is legally very important for the patient, and the prognosis and the condition has to be explained to the patient and its attenders. So ultrasound preoperatively, it is very important because to know the amount of degree of vitreous exudates and to know about if there is any retinal detachment or choroidal detachment, and the quadrant in which the choroidal detachment is there should be noted. So the objectives of our treatment should be to eradicate or control the infection and to manage its complications and to restore the vision. If not, the secondary objective should be to relieve the symptom of the patient and to prevent panophthalmitis. So how do we go ahead with the patient? So once the patient has been diagnosed and consent has been taken, we go ahead with vitreous tap and AC tap along with intravitreal antibiotics. So the most important part is that patient has to be informed, and the sample has to be sent to the nearby microbiological center, and there shouldn't be any cross contamination. So that's most important, and the culture has to be processed very immediately. It has to be sent for gram stain and KOH mount, and culture for bacterial and fungal has to be done. So once the injection has been given, so within 24 hours, we should see for the response. If there is improving media clarity, if there is disappearing hypopyon, and if vision improves, then we will wait for the culture report, and then we'll continue the same medication. And after 48 hours, we will repeat the intravitreal antibiotics depending upon the culture sensitivity and the type of organism found. If the condition is worsening, then we'll take the patient for core vitrectomy. So in meanwhile, we'll continue with the topical and systemic medication. The role of steroids, definitely if it is acute, most probably if it is bacterial, we will try to give intravitreal steroids as well, and immediately after topical steroids to control the infection, inflammation. And this is our AuroLab e-kit is available. We have the entire antibiotic spectrum along with the entire materials for the core vitrectomy as well as intravitreal tap. And this is the chart which is showing how to prepare the common dose of intravitreal antibiotic agents and how to choose the intravitreal antibiotic. So the spectrum should cover for both gram-positive and gram-negative organisms. So commonly we use vancomycin and cefazolin for gram-positive, and for gram-negative we use ceftazidime, amikacin and gentamicin. So the advantage of vitrectomy is that it reduces the infection load, it helps in selecting the microbiological vitreous biopsy to send for culture, and it helps in clearing the media clarity, and it reduces the inflammatory chain, and it helps in direct delivery of intravitreal antibiotics. So to start with the procedure, the most important and first step is the infusion. So since the end of patients, mostly the media clarity will be very poor. So you have to make sure that the infusion is within the vitreous cavity. So mostly if it is very dense media is very poor, then we can use 20 gauge or 23 gauge 6 millimeter cannula. And if there is any preoperative quadrant of any CD or RD, it should be avoided. We can put the infusion in some other quadrants. Vitreous biopsy is very important, and to avoid dilution, before switching on to the infusion, we need to connect a syringe to the aspiration tube, and the mouth of the cutter should be visible to our view, and we can use high cut rate and low suction, and at least 0.5 ml of sample has to be taken. And the media opacity, if there is any corneal infiltrates or any ulcer, we can use keratoprosthesis. If there is anterior chamber hypopyon or inflammatory membrane, it should be cleared off, and the sample can be sent for biopsy as well. And if there is IOL deposits, it should be cleaned. And if there is any posterior capsular inflammation or infection, it should be done with a posterior capsulotomy. And in case of delayed postoperative endophthalmitis, we should give bag wash. In case of recurrent postoperative late endophthalmitis, we can give remove the IOL bag complex as well. So core vitrectomy, it has to be always done under the visualization. It should be done from anterior to posterior. Use always low vacuum and high cut rate. If there is any active bleeding, it is an indication that there is a damage to retina and choroid. So endpoint, so EVS did not advocate the indication of induction of PVD. So if you see a posterior pole, disc and first order vessels are visible, that's the endpoint for core vitrectomy. So avoid aggressive removal of vitreous. This is a short video showing a case of postoperative endophthalmitis. So you can see there is a dense I'll skip that. So you should avoid violent PVD induction, and aggressive peripheral vitrectomy should be avoided, and rapid suction should be avoided, and definitely fluid air exchange should be avoided in case of endophthalmitis. So the role of PVD, ESCRS recommends it's only in the case of experienced vitreoretinal surgeons they have advised induction of PVD, whereas in cases of complete endophthalmitis vitrectomy study, they have advised PVD induction. Even they have advised at the areas of necrotic retina, it should be avoided. So intravitreal antibiotic should be given in the mid vitreous cavity slowly. The bevel should be always away from macula. The separate needles should be used to avoid flocculation. So the alternative for, especially for Pseudomonas, we can use piperacillin tazobactam, and for MRSA, we can use clindamycin. For fungal endophthalmitis, we have amphotericin, fluconazole, and voriconazole. The role of silicone oil, routinely we don't use silicone oil for all the patients. Especially when you have a recurrent endophthalmitis, recurrent media clarities and vitritis, we can use silicone oil. Especially if there is a retinal break or extensive areas of retinal necrosis, we can use silicone oil. Other than that, if we have not completely inadequate removal of vitreous is done, avoid using silicone oil because it might lead to compartmentalization. So wound closure is very important. Ports as well as corneal entry should be closed. So to conclude, endophthalmitis remains a devastating complication. In current advancement, we can always go ahead for early vitrectomy. However, it should be done with the safe limits. So management should be individualized to the particular patient. Thank you.
I think he has covered most of the essentials. Is there anything the expert, Malika, you want to comment on anything?
Endophthalmitis study which you mentioned, that is for very serious endophthalmitis, severe endophthalmitis. There it is proposed that even in the first intervention, you do a complete vitrectomy, PVD induction, remove all the exudates, do laser for any breaks, so that reduces the risk of reactivation of the endophthalmitis. But by and large, mostly core vitrectomy with intravitreal injections in the first sitting is enough.
Dr. Naresh, please.
No introduction. He's the chief of the retina and vitreous services from Arvind Eye Care Systems, Madurai. And he's going to be telling us something about optic disc pit, surgical outcomes of different techniques and preferred practice guidelines to that. crisply for 6 minutes and discussion. If we have time at the end, we could have more discussions. And for a short while, I'm going to hand over the mic to Dr. Tennerson to take care. I would want all of you to stay here right till the end. I'm sure you'll learn at the end of it.
Tera, start. Okay. Thank you, madam, for the invitation. Actually, the preferred practice pattern, I don't know what exactly it is for ODP, it's quite confusing. It's not that difficult, I mean, rare a case. Quite often we come across in this case, at least we operate 2 to 3 every week, actually. So it's not that rare thing. It's quite male and female are equally affected. And we get even multiple pits also. So this is how it appears. It appears like a gray or white or yellow or a black thing. There may be a variation. The reason I am saying is the first preferred practice starts with the diagnosis of the OD pit. I'll just show you, this was a case. You have to identify. This was diagnosed as a case of a CSR. So this girl underwent every other investigation, believe me, by a retina specialist. By saying this, I am not saying I have not done this. Maybe a few years ago, even I would have done this mistake. Maybe my boss, Kim sir, is there, he might be telling whether I have done that mistake in the discussion. So they have done the FFA, nothing has come. Then they found there is some temporal palate, they sent it to neuroclinic, actually. The only thing they do is to do MRI, actually. Ultimately, when the case was sent to us with a 90 diopter and OCT, yes, this was diagnosed. So diagnosing, OD pit starts with the diagnosis. Diagnosing OD pit is the most simplest thing. All you need is a 90 diopter lens. Whenever there is a case like CSR, look at the disc always. So all CSR are not CSR. It may be a OD pit with maculopathy. So look at the disc, look for the grayish thing, and sometimes you'll come across 2 or 3 pits also. So this is about the diagnosing. And of course, you will have a multi-layered fluid when you do the OCT. And again, I'll not go into the detail. So we have got a lot of treatment options. In case in the OPD, if the OD pit is incidentally, detected, if they don't have any maculopathy or if there is no loss of vision, just observe and counsel the risk of development of maculopathy so they can be kept under regular follow-up. They can go up to yearly follow-up. Don't go for any prophylactic laser because when you calculate the risk versus benefit, it is more detrimental. In fact, it never should be done. Because with ODPM with vision loss, there is always a spontaneous resolution in 25% of the cases, but we don't know which 25% because we always get that the rest 25% to us, and this 25% which resolves spontaneously always goes to our competitor, actually, in my opinion, because the one which never settles are the one which come to us. But when it settles spontaneously, the visual outcome is poor. So when you find a maculopathy, go for the surgical management. Usually, if you are going to observe this case with the maculopathy, it is not justified. A very aggressive surgical approach is required. So these are the basic, the treatment option for OD pit. The first one is laser alone. Okay, so it basically induces the juxtapapillary colorectal scar. Thereby, it acts as a barrier for the fluid to migrate from the ON optic nerve into the macular area, and it is quite infective. So actually, these are few cases which we have done laser a long time back. It might look nice, actually, but if you see the macula, it's gone, totally degenerated. The outcome is bad. That's why I've written, actually, for OD pit laser alone, you have to write the obituary for this treatment, actually, like how we have written for this. Smallpox, ODPM laser is an obituary which has to be written. So the other options available are we can go for surgical management. So before that, you can just inject gas with or without laser. But if you see, the results are not that great, actually. Macular buckle, yes, you can do. But it's quite a demanding procedure, number one. And number two, actually, you have to be a very good, trained retina surgeon. And number three, it's quite expensive. And the cost is also quite prohibitory. And quite a complicated surgical technique, actually, to start with. Once if you master, everything is going to be very simple. And it's not widely accepted as a treatment option. The other most widely accepted treatment option are inducing the PVD, right? Thereby, you release the forces. So along with the vitrectomy, these are the things which we are using. So you just go for laser treatment. I said, no more, it is done. Then you can do an ILM peeling, because the fovea is going to be very thin. And if you're going to peel the ILM, there is every chance that you might create a macular hole. So people have done the fovea sparing ILM peeling also. But this is not done anymore, because we have got other options. One of the options is just plugging, because whether it's a macular hole or OD pit, whatever we find, we want to just plug it into the, the OD pit and the macular hole. So one is the ILM, the other one is the, the scleral plug, okay? So we have compared all these three. So this is one of the case where we have done the ILM plug, and the second is the, the scleral plug. It's a very simple technique. After doing a complete vitrectomy, the videos are not playing. Okay, so after doing the vitrectomy, infronasal or infrotemporal quadrant, just with the crescent blade, make a small, raise a small, partial thickness scleral flap. Okay, trim it as per the thing. If you see, it's all three plugs, ports are 25. But usually, negotiating this into the 25 is very difficult, so one port is converted into 23. And usually, I do it under the air. After doing a complete fluid air exchange, you just take the plug and snugly fit it into the OD pit. That's it. There is no bleeding happening. It's not that difficult. That's it. And it stays for at least 1 or 2 years. Tena, one more minute. Okay. Yeah. Sorry. So these are the cases with OD pit. The result, if you see what has happened in our case, actually, all these three were compared. When you see, actually, complete anatomical success was achieved in equally in the scleral plug as well as ILM, but the vision is better in ILM case. The reason we found is, like, when you are plugging the scleral plug, there is every chance that you might be damaging the retinal nerve fibers, but it doesn't happen so in this. But the scleral plug is very good or very useful if you have multiple plugs. And even if you lose the ILM when you are doing the surgery, as an alternate, you can always use a scleral plug. And it proves to be a very good option, because the resolution happens within 3 to 6 months, because it has an intimate relationship with the optic nerve, and it is a relatively easy to obtain the scleral plug rather than the ILM plug. And the ILM plug never that snugly fits, and there is a higher stability if you're plugging it with the scleral plug. But there are certain problems, like you can have the mechanical damage to the optic nerve, or you can have bleeding, but rarely it happens, actually. And there is some silhouette artery occlusion also, which we have not come. And we have got cases with double pit, triple pit also in the same eye. And they do well with this, because as I said, ILM is not sufficient for filling multiple. And we have done, now currently under review, we are using the, PRP. It's not a pan-retinal photocoagulation. It is a platelet-rich plasma, which we harvest from the patient just before, 20 minutes before the surgery. And at the end of the surgery, just 2 or 3 drops over the optic disc and then close it with the gas. The results are quite encouraging. Maybe once it is done, we'll do it. So this is how we do that, 18 ml of blood with 2 ml of ACD, and then centrifuge twice. You get almost 10 lakh per cubic millimeter platelet, quite good for this. And platelet-rich plasma is an antibiotic, except for Klebsiella, it acts against every other bacteria, so just don't bother. Even in endophthalmitis, you can try this if your antibiotics are acting. The other adjuncts are, for want of time, I'll just skip. People have used plugs also. Okay, so in conclusion, diagnosis is very, very important. It can be done just with a 90 diopter lens. You don't need any sophisticated instrument. But any case of CSR, as I have told, or any case with a serous detachment over the macula, look at the disc, look for any pit, and then you proceed for further investigation or accordingly. There is no role for prophylactic laser. Never do that. In case if it is incidental finding, you can observe. But once the patient develops maculopathy, go for surgery. Vitrectomy is the most common. We do both ILM peeling and scleral plug. Plug gives a very good result. Maybe other adjuncts in future, we'll get to know what the results are. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for that nice presentation. Dr. Mallika, you would like to share your thoughts on the presentation?
It's a good presentation. I agree that not in every case ILM stays there. Possibly if you put visco on the ILM flap, it may stay. That has been my experience. So I think it's a wonderful presentation. And a good thing which he has mentioned is that laser should not be attempted. Most of the times we see that people have attempted laser first and waited for a few months or years and then gone for surgery. Best to go for surgery.
That's for diagnosis also.
Of course.
Dr. Avinash sir.
No, it is 87, 85,
yeah.
And 25 actually. It's not 100% and it takes time. But it's quite early in case of scleral plug, slightly delayed in case of, and in case of ILM, ILM peeling alone, it takes a very long time. It never settles rather. So actually in the first, plug, it is 3 to 6 months. In fact, after 9 months also, it never resolved in case of just ILM peeling with the gas.
Thank you, sir. We would like to invite the next speaker.
Just one additional point.
Sorry.
The symptom for diagnosis, the disc which has the pit is always larger.
Yes.
So that's something which can be looked at when a suspicion of optic disc pit with neurosensory attachment is thought of. And number two is if the configuration of the fluid which has a bottleneck going towards, if we have a patient with central serous, but it bottlenecks towards the optic nerve head, that's another time when people have to consider a possibility of optic disc pit.
Yeah, with due respect to all our glaucoma colleagues, actually, I forgot to tell one thing. The field effects in OD pit can mimic any of the glaucoma fields. So they should not think that it's glaucoma and treat it with anti-glaucoma medication. Better they can send it to us. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I would now like to invite Dr. Pramod Bende, sir. He needs no introduction. Senior consultant at Shankar Netralaya Chennai, our teacher and guru. He will be talking on myopic macular sclerosis, diagnosis, management, and follow-up preferred practice guidelines. Dr. Pramod Bende, sir.
Thank you very much. Yeah, it's there. Thank you very much for the invitation, and I would like to acknowledge help from my colleague Dr. Pradeep to get this presentation ready. So basically, macrosclerosis was first described by Takano and Kishi in 1999 using time domain OCT, and basically it's considered as a splitting of the inner retinal layers at the macula in patient with high myopia and having a posterior strapiloma. Various definitions and terminologies being used like myopic foveosclerosis, maculosclerosis, retinosclerosis at the macula. Prevalence is somewhere between 8 to 34% of eyes in those having a pathological myopia. And presently accepted terminology is basically maculosclerosis, and defined as an increased thickness of the neurosensory retina with a column-like structures at the macula of the myopic eyes. There are different types depending on structural changes. Like inner maculosclerosis, where there is thickness of inner retinal layers in a column-like structure at a different layer between inner layer and ILM. Outer maculosclerosis, where similar column-like structure you see starting from the outer flexipam limb going up to external limiting membrane. You can have both inner and outer maculosclerosis. You can have maculosclerosis with macular detachment, generally have associated neurosensory detachment along with maculosclerosis, and then you can have a macular detachment without full thickness macular hole, where a neurosensory detachment of the macula with a separation of photoreceptors from the RP, the macular detachment involves the whole macula with no area of sclerosis visible, and occasionally the detachment may extend beyond the posterior pole. We can have an inner lamellar macular hole, where a splitting of the inner foveal layers can happen, developing from the internal limiting membrane, but not reaching up to the photoreceptor. And then you have outer lamellar macular hole, where splitting and interruption of the photoreceptor are towards the RP side. Then comes macular detachment with this. Basically, these all different combination clinical presentations, what you see, where RD is limited to macula with full thickness macular hole. So coming to investigation, we have fundus photography, OCT, ultrasound, ultrasound B scan. MRI, very rarely we use, particularly when you are planning the macular buccal to assess the strapiloma shape, location, and dimensions. So fundus photocopy obviously useful for a documentation. They are different. You see here, it's having a posterior scapuloma. You can make out foveal detachment here, shallow detachment. You can make out, though suspicion is there, macular hole here, but basically OCT is a better investigation to look at it. Ultrasonography you do not need for diagnosis, but it gives you again the dimensions of a scapuloma, and that probably help you to plan management whether to have a buccal or to have a vitrectomy. So again, as far as again new classification, they are developed in a stages and typing depending on whether there is an anteroposterior traction or horizontal or tangential traction. So looking at a vertical changes, what you talk about stage one, where there is inner or inner outer ascites. Stage two is purely outer ascites. Stage three is neurosensory detachment at the fovea. And stage four is detachment extending to the whole posterior pole, but here ascites disappears because of probably anteroposterior traction is disappear. Horizontally, when you go, there's normal foveal contour, and because of tangential stretching, you can either have a inner lamellar hole, that is a type B, and C is full thickness macular hole. When you look at a natural course, that when a progression of with a timeline, inner direct stage one to going to stage two, it takes almost average 40 months. It's a little bit more or less. We are looking at averages. But as if the disease progresses, like a duration reduces, stage two, from stage two to stage two is somewhere averaged duration is 12 months, and from stage two to stage four, it will be average 3 months. So why it is important when you come to the management, there are four different options. What we have is observation, vitrectomy, macular buccal, or imbrication. So when you look at stage one and stage two, as we know, there's 40 months generally is unpredictable natural history. It may remain stable for many more months or years sometime. And so we suggest that if there's immediate surgical intervention should not be considered when you are dealing with a stage one or stage two, but of course these eyes need a regular follow-up as well. Now, mean time to progress from stage one to two, as I say, is the slowest. So stage one where disease should be followed probably every 1 year. Stage two, probably you can follow every 6 months, and stage three or four, stage three generally around somewhere 6 to 12 weeks, and obviously when you reach to stage four, probably this is the time you take them for surgery. Parameters for a surgical intervention, you look at it basically recent onset of a new symptom or recent worsening of the metamorphopsia and visual acuity, that probably should be considered as an indication for a surgery, along with your progression on a OCT and your associated posterior scapuloma or significant of associate myopic maculopathy changes like a patchy atrophy, CNVM, etc., because that again will help you to discuss prognosis with the patient and attendants. So vitrectomy is considered when their maculoscisis is there with a severe tangential traction, and macular buccal when you plan when there is a predominantly anteroposterior traction where you have a generally large scapuloma. So, and combination obviously buccal with a vitrectomy when you have both anteroposterior and tangential traction. So we have macular detachment, full thickness hole, failed previous surgery along with the foveal ascites. So scleral imbrication rarely being done, where axial length is very high, macular detachment is associated with or without full thickness macula, and particularly failed surgery. So just to algorithm, when you have posterior scapuloma, if it's shallow, or in some cases you can manage with a macular buccal, but if you have deep scapuloma and you have associated full thickness macular hole, even with a shallow scapuloma, probably your vitrectomy would be the better option. As far as surgical plan is concerned, generally a complete vitrectomy done. You have to ensure that PVD is induced because there's a vitreoscisis is there, multiple layers we need to, so multiple staining with the tricot and ensuring that entire vitreous is removed, followed by large ILM peeling. If there's a macular hole, you can even try flap to cover that macular hole, and generally tamponade can be C3 effect gas or silicone oil depending on additional breaks and experience of the surgeon. So scleral buckling, obviously, if you have previously buckling done, those eyes, scleral buckling, macular buccal is practically impossible, so those eyes resort for a vitrectomy. These are just few references for because adding on as a preferred practice pattern. Thank you very much for patient hearing.
Thank you so much. Dr. Raja, you would like to share your thoughts on the presentation?
Very nice presentation, Dr. Modbender. I just had a query on the macular buccal, like there are two sides of a divide. some people who were doing macular buccal more often earlier have stopped doing and are doing only vitrectomy, at least as a first attempt. You know, at least in those cases where you mentioned the anterior posterior traction, even if it's limited to, let's say, only the macular sclerosis and maybe a small NSD, are you doing macular buccal or would you recommend only vitrectomy as a first attempt?
Again, as I said, case to case we decide. Just only have a shallow detachment, posterior pole, associated my hole. And scapulum is not that large enough. And you feel, looking at the OCT, looking at your clinical impression, tangential traction is more, probably I would go ahead with vitrectomy. But where is a deep scapuloma, you can look at, again, OCT, take a measurement, and also sometime MRI we do initially. We realize probably there's a obviously shortening, and when you try to settle only with vitrectomy, this retina is not going to settle. It's just going to have a something like a type 2 closure. Probably they will do better with macular buccal as well. And then combination of both, depending on you have a macular hole, you also have a large scapuloma, you go with both. But each case is different, not sticking to just only vitrectomy or only buccal.
Do you do a fovea sparing ILM peel in these patients? Fovea sparing?
Rather than that, I would say, yes, it become partly fovea sparing because if a large hole is there, probably we will try to cover temporal flap, bringing inverse flap over the macular area. But reaching for a ILM peeling, this eye is like a high myope axial lane, is not that easy. And because there is no contrast, that again is extremely difficult.
What is the macular buccal that you use like most commonly?
Moran Davis, we are having it comes for this one. We are not using, this is like a T-shaped buccal.
Yeah.
And FCI is having marketing now. In India, it used to be size something now, French company, but I think biomedics, I think they have now. FCI initially used to come then.
Okay.
It's easily available, that one.
Thank you very much. Anybody
Thank
from
you.
The audience would like to ask something? Go ahead.
Excuse me, sir.
Sir, one more question, sir.
So how do you modify in cases of axial in more than 28, 30? Vitrectomy, how do you do a modification?
Yeah, basically, modification at every level, right from the sclerotomy. Probably you make the sclerotomy more posterior because these eyes overall also probably is gone down. Sometimes you can do transillumination or you can even localize doing indirect ophthalmoscopy somewhere near aura and you know how far posterior it is. Go a little bit more horizontal meridian. Again, obviously, 23 gauge system, no question of 25 here. Because flexibility will be issue and sometimes reach also will be issue because particularly 25 plus 25 millimeter again goes. That's the difficulty. I do not hesitate if something I'm having a more than 30 or 35 somewhere going back to 20. We have long forceps and back flush needle to reach the posterior pole. Okay. So, and obviously you sometimes do get away without cannula, so that extra 2 millimeter you get hub of the your trocar cannula system. So just like a 20 gauge conventional, you use 23, but without cannulas.
Thank you, sir. We'll move on to the next speaker, Dr. Srinivas M. Joshi. He's a senior vitreoretinal consultant from M.M. Joshi Eye Hospital, Hubli. He's doing some amazing vitreoretinal surgeries, especially with this new tool of three-dimensional. And Dr. Srinivas Joshi is also academic and research committee representative for South India.
Thank you so much. Welcome to our ARC session on preferred practice guidelines. So quickly, the topic given to me is by Dr. Chitra is the biomarkers and the predictors. So I'll quickly try to go out. So as we all know, the biomarker, merged word of biological marker, refers to a broad subcategory of the medical science. It could be anatomical, biochemical, molecular, and it's again useful in refinement of the diagnosis, progression, or predicting and monitoring. That is what is important. So the ideal biomarker is through which a disease comes about, through which an intervention alters the disease, consistently and accurately predicts the clinical outcome, and also serves as a progression marker. So these are the various OCT-based markers. I'll not go into this slide. But how the cystoid changes can occur? As we all know, the DME will initially show ONL and Henle's layer cyst caused by these microaneurysms located more deeply in the retina, and the outer retinal fluid accumulation may also result because of the blood retinal barrier breakdown. So because of the accumulation of the extracellular fluid and expansion of the tissue, mainly causing the functional loss, and progressive breakdown of these intervening septa causing the cysts to coalesce, and predominant connection between the inner and the outer retina are lost, and because of which a significant impairment leading to the consequent functional loss can happen. So let's look at it, both the situation horizontally and vertically. So in this paper done by Dr. Rajiv Raman and Muna Bhende, and also the Canadian Ophthalmological Society, done by one of my mentor, Dr. Lam, so this very clearly mentions DME, non-center involving, center involving, no vision observed, vision loss, then start ahead with a monotherapy. Location of the cystoid spaces, if it is center involving, and we divide it either into center and a non-center involving. So the size of the cystoid spaces is again an important biomarker. In this paper, it's been very nicely published, says that anything more than 100 micron is called as a small. Large is called as 100 to 200, and the giant if it is more than 200. The most important thing is the bridging retinal processes, that is the BRP, which also indicates it's one of the important biomarker for this. So coming to the center involving, we all know that it's cystoid spaces involving the center, and usually the central subfield thickness is more than 305 microns in women and more than 320 in men. So non-center involving, again, apart from the fovea, if you have, they call it as a non, see, this is the case where we get the intravitreal injection and the patient doing very well. These center involving do perfectly well with this anti-VEGF itself. This is another case having 636 vision, center involving edema, post-IVB itself. You can see that though there is no much improvement. And then we shifted this patient from pre-Ozurdex to post-Ozurdex. So I'll come about when I prefer to use this DEX implants, especially using these OCTs as a biomarker. Now, if you look into the protocol V trial, results favor good observation strategy for especially for the patients with DME with good vision. So here you can see the non-center involving anti-VEGF was injected because the patient complained of diminution of vision. However, the patient was N6 post-injection. So this is again center to non-center involving macular edema, the pre-injection 618 and the post-injection you can see 1 month it is 612 and N8. So 2 months later, the patient was not actually very affordable. So what we thought we could try a micropulse laser in this. I think in the National Symposium we had a great discussion on the micropulse laser. I'll not go into again more details on that. We have spent a lot of time today on the micropulse. But yes, definitely when it's the less edema is there, micropulse does work in certain amount of cases. And especially in CSR also, if the fluid, the retinal thickness is less than 350 or 300, I think it does have a role. It can definitely make some good improvement. Coming to the vertical, the intraretinal location of the cystoid spaces, basically in INL because of the leakage from the capillaries, ONL is because of the disruption of the ORB, and SRF is ES and EZ and RP. So the OCT features, what are the OCT features of recalcitrant diabetic macular edema? The large cystoid spaces, the hard exudates, the hyperreflective foci, the subretinal hard exudate. So these are the worst visual prognosis, especially for patients who have recalcitrant diabetic macular edema. So in this published paper, they say that trends towards greater resolution of submacular fluid after steroid treatment versus anti-VEGF was 86% to 50%. So the presence of the SRF may indicate a different disease altogether. If NSD is present, then look into the more that CMT thickness, choroidal thickness, secondary to the damaged ELM, disrupted ELM correlated with the height of the NSD. But whereas in absent NSD, you can the CMT is less, ELM is intact, and choroid is usually thinner. So this is another paper which says about the hyperreflective foci. I don't know how many of us actually try to count these in the busy clinical practice, but definitely worth mentioning it. Hyperreflective foci 2 to 10, moderate it is termed as 11 to 20, and many if it is more than 21. So with the progressing retinopathy, the hyperreflective foci reach the outer retinal layers. So again, the ISO is integrity is again an important point here. The breach in the ISO is integrity is also a poor biomarker. The points in the drill to highlight is the association with the visual prognosis. It's basically the disruption of the impulse transmission, the retinal inner layers because of the disorganization of the retinal inner layers. And this is the patient 2 months and 3 months post Ozurdex. You can see here, post-injection, the patient really did well, but it was only an anatomical improvement, but not of much. You can see there is definitely a disorganization of the retinal inner layer, and this is again, there was a recurrence, and again we re-injected in this patient. Although these patients have a little bit of improvement, but not to great extent. So coming to the next is the choroidal surrogate markers. Choroidal thickness is usually reduced in DME. The thicker choroids responds better to the steroids, and the choroidal vascular index also reduces with increasing severity of the DR. So last two slides, the indications of steroid over the anti-VEGF, where I choose is more of HRF, more of CMT, more of hard exudates, although there is no very conclusive evidence, and the two-year comparison head-on study has shown that the anti-VEGF and Ozurdex both work pretty much well, but the first year, it has been shown that the Ozurdex implants does much better than that, but long-term study has shown both are equally important, and again, the neurosensory detachment. Thank you very much for the patient listening.
Thank you, Dr. Srinivas. Dr. Mallika, your thoughts on this talk, please.
Yes, in the last slide, which he showed that the steroids are preferred over, those are really thoughts, and there are no studies to show that in a case of exudates or NSD even, steroid gives better response. So the steroid has side effects. We have to take that with a pinch of salt, and I think steroid should be a choice, second choice, if anti-VEGF has not worked. Not simply because there is NSD or HRF or exudate, would you jump to steroid as the first option.
Dr. Raja, please.
I agree with Dr. Mallika in the sense we discuss a lot about these biomarkers, but for me the straightforward, simple, most important is macular edema. More the edema, more will be the gain in vision when we treat these patients. So this is across, not just DME, it's for RVO, it's for CNVM also. If the presentation baseline edema is more, that patient, if you treat, the gain in vision is also more. But I had one question that where you had counted, you know, mentioned less than 10, 10 to 20, more than 20 reflective dots. I mean, how do you use that? In terms of, you know, it's a single scan you're talking, and it may not be passing through a particular area where there may be more dots. A cube probably would give a better idea, but how do you even use that information?
That's what, sir. I don't really use that. I roughly count that. If it's more than 20, it's basically what I use it as a counseling tool, that's it.
For what? I mean, what can you even counsel with that?
See, in these patients where they expect too much improvement of the vision, and it has been shown that more of the hyperreflective foci are already, these are the precursors of the hard exudates. And definitely these do not have as much as patients who are not having the HRF foci. So I just use them randomly, but to be frank with you, I that's why I said to mention it, because I had to mention it as one of the OCT biomarkers which has been mentioned. I clinically don't, it's very difficult for me to sit and count all those things. I personally don't do that. But I would love to know the comments from the expert panel. If it's really of worth useful, then I'll start marking it.
I think Trehan has written a nice article in one of the, I think, VRSA issues of which biomarker has what value, what is the evidence for that. From that perspective, I think high reflective dots don't have much of
importance.
A drill definitely has in terms of the overall final vision they are likely to get or not get. That has a better prognostic marker. But edema is there, even if drill is there or not there, doesn't matter. Edema is there, you treat it, the patient will be.
Dr. Avinash, sir?
No, I think it's one and the same, because we have been having the discussion for ad nauseum for so many years. Now, what we discuss here, I'm just going to give a different picture. What we discuss here and what is being practiced in the real world scenario in 90% of the setting is something which is different. So there, the thought process is again driven primarily whether what type of anti-VEGF would influence the clinical practice in the primary setting of treatment. So when there is a recurrence, then you have a different way of thoughts. But majority of them in a primary setting in day-to-day practice or real-world scenario do not consider corticosteroids as a primary modality of treatment even today. So with that being the driving force, and you have a multifactorial reasons just apart from OCT biomarkers itself, which can influence the outcome of treatment. I would say just discussing 360 degrees, that these are the only things which would have to consider for a probable better outcome would not fill in all the blanks in the management of DNA.
Thank you, sir.
But the only advantage with that is it's a longer acting, and patients who don't want monthly injections or looking into the economics and ergonomics, that's one condition where I think it can be considered. I understand, madam, but I
thank you for paucity of time. We'll
sitting there. I don't live in Hyderabad, but definitely.
Thank you very much. Thank you. It's an absolute honor and pleasure to welcome the president of All India Ophthalmological Society, our next speaker, Dr. Lalit Verma, sir, who needs absolutely no introduction. But if everybody kept on saying he needs no introduction, the young kids will, at the end of the decade, will not know who are the senior people. So it's important to introduce. Sir was a professor at RP Center, and then now he's the senior consultant at Center for Sight in New Delhi. And presently, yesterday, he was installed as the president of All India Ophthalmic Society. Dr. Lalit Verma will be speaking on role of FFA in the era of OCT, OCTA, FAF, preferred practice guidelines. Dr. Lalit Verma, sir.
Firstly, presidency has nothing to do with this lecture. And secondly, I still remain a junior resident. Only because same job which we started doing in 1982, same thing I'm doing still today. Nothing has changed in my life. So thank you so much for having me here.
Mic on hai, sarkar.
So I am here to basically speak or defend FFA. Maybe I have less experience with Octa, but there are situations where I still feel FFA has a role to play. You see, fundus imaging modalities, you keep counting, they are more than 10 or so. Red, free, so many, all are enumerated. I'll not read all of them. But despite all this, so many imaging modalities, we talk of multimodal imaging. Even in this era, FFA still has a role to play and has been there for decades and decades since, you know, I know Tony Elvis, they introduced this gold standard imaging for posterior segment imaging. Even in FFA, we have now wide field or conventional FA also, and ultra wide field, and SLO-based FA also. The advantages of FA, which I feel is, firstly, the experience, the way we have been brought up, does not mean that we don't want to keep pace with the newer technology. Wider field compared to the most of the octas available, although I know the wide field octas are also increasingly becoming available. Very important is in patients who have hazy media, like something like asteroid hyalosis or other media hazy or motion dependent, FFA will yield more information compared to Octa. The other fourth thing is that it's a dynamic study. If you want to study leakage or pooling in FPED, that information, unless you have volumetric or functional analysis in Octa, is very well picked up on CNP areas, can be picked up by both non-perfusion areas, but leakage. In Octa, you may pick up a neovascularization, but whether it's active or not, it's not so easy, although there are changes described whether this neovascularization is active or not. So therefore, new terminology came that it's a silent CNVM, whether to treat or not. But if I have to treat, I will definitely get an FA done rather than depending only on the Octa findings. The problems with FA which are over-exaggerated are that, problems of allergy and anaphylaxis and death. It's although death also has been reported, but it's odd one case in, so many millions and millions. And allergy or this thing occurs in, say, around less than 5% of patients. Limitations of FFA, although we have ICG, is that deeper or segmentation of retinal layers we can't do on FA. And it requires some time. You see, time it takes minimum of 5 to 7 minutes for good angiography. ICG takes around 15 to 20 minutes. So this chart I tabulated, saying the same things, that on FFA we can have with Octos 200 field, but in Octa, in majority of the Octa machines available is 6 or 12 wide field. Although wide field is also becoming available. But very few people will have that. Safety point of view, Octa non-invasive, this is considered invasive because there is an injection element involved. And contraindication, obviously Octa, as I said, Octa may not yield good information in hazy media, or if you know, there are motion artifacts also in here. But in FFA, there may be, you know, contraindications like pregnancy or other issues. Resolution is definitely higher in Okta. And if you do SLO based, then resolution is very good in FFA also. Very important is the level of imaging. Here in Okta, you can have NFAS images, and you can, you know, dissect superficial, deeper retina, outer retina, and also choroid. Whereas in FFA, the main information is, you know, towards superficial retina only. The other thing is that FFA is a dynamic structure. You follow these frames, you know, over 5 minutes, what's happening to that white spot, what's happening to that black area, whereas Okta provides static information. Okta is very quick, FFA will take a couple of minutes. And motion, as I said, Okta gets more affected than FFA is less affected. And also media haze, FFA yields much more information than Okta. From cost point of view, FFA obviously is much cheaper. Okta is becoming more and more costlier. And we have long decades of experience with FFA. Okta is picking up and becoming a threat to FFA. So these are some conditions which I picked up where FFA has an edge over Okta, like peripheral lesions, like your lesion depicted on the right side. This may not be easier picked up, especially in these CNP areas, with a conventional Okta may be missed. So therefore, I'll be totally depending on angiography to pick up peripheral CNVs, patients of Ehlers disease, vasculitis, so on fundus fluorescein angiography. Same is true for picking up these leakages, which are very easily picked up on FFA. Suppose I have to laser any patient or focal laser in diabetic macular edema, I'll always have an angiography done, pick up those areas of leakage, or even in CSR, we'll pick up and then attempt to do focal laser in such patients. Same is true for this patient who had, you know, although Okta revealed CNVM, but whether it's regressed or confirmed, although, you know, appearance like Medusa appearance, although they do tell us, but it most likely is regressed. But in my practice, I will definitely depend on FA in these patients. Ultra wide field FA is definitely a reality. Optos machines, all of you know about it. Motion artifacts are a problem in Okta, but not in FFA. Poor visual acuity and limited fixation are not so much of a drawback on FA. As I said, astigmatism, always prefer angiography rather than this. And decision and precision of focal laser, as I said, in patients of DME, CSR, COATS. So here, I depend more on information provided by fundus fluorescein angiography rather than Okta. And similarly, microorganisms, although can be, you know, with identified in Okta, but more readily visualized on angiography. And similarly, this will show a SRF kind of fluid. But if you want to clearly distinguish between these, this provides, you see, immediate information within 5 minutes. So future, I know Okta is a big threat to FA, but I believe FA as of now is not dead. And more developments are taking place in Okta and is gradually replacing FA and may become the only imaging tool for vascular pathologies. But as of now, I think FA still is a gold standard. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Malika, madam, please.
One of the indications can be to distinguish between true disc edema and pseudo edema. Again, there the Okta may not show much, but it will leak if it's a true disc edema, whereas pseudo edema will not
leakage is an issue. So wheresoever leakage is an issue, yes. Like in CSR or yes. Diabetes, so yes. FA is always preferable.
Any other comments from the other panelists, or shall we?
Sometimes FA can show new vessels on the iris as well. You're doing it for the posterior segment, but you start seeing massive leak from the iris, which you don't see clinically the new vessels at all.
Yeah, sometimes you see if there are subtle, and you have not picked up previously on slit lamp, then you have made a blunder by not picking up, then it will become slightly hazier after a couple of minutes.
Yes.
Just other additional point again. Old school of thoughts, if still people believe in lasers, sometimes which we have to do, it is better picked on fluorescein than an Okta.
What's that, Avinash?
Aneurysms.
Aneurysms.
Yeah, any leakage, CSR. wherever you want to direct a treatment based on the FA.
100%. Nobody will have, I think, guts to do laser without angiography report. And normally we project FA and identify the vascular landmark or something.
Right. Thank you. Thank you, Lalit sir. Thank you so much for this wonderful talk. Now I request, on behalf of Dr. Vishali Gupta, we have Dr. Anirudh Agarwal, who finished his postdoctoral fellow at University of Nebraska, and now he is a consultant at Cleveland Clinic in Abu Dhabi. So he'll be presenting a talk on ocular TB or toxoplasmic retinochoroiditis. What are the preferred practice guidelines?
Thank you very much, sir. So on behalf of Dr. Vishali, I'll be speaking on the preferred practice guidelines in the management of TB. So I'll be presenting six steps that we commonly follow in our clinics, and a lot of this has been obtained from the collaborative ocular TB study and a lot of the international collaborations that we have done in the past few years. So the first step is always in ocular TB is to look at the patient clinically and see what are the signs and the features that we see on the anterior segment as well as posterior segment. So if you have a patient, look always for the classic phenotypes. Dr. Patange is here. He's also described some of the phenotypes. But predominantly, it's a granulomatous active anterior uveitis, acute anterior uveitis with mutton fat KPs and Busakas and Koppe's nodules. And a classic of TB also is chronic recurrent granulomatous uveitis. Tubercles are common in the posterior segment as well as serpiginous-like choroiditis. Serpiginous-like is actually a very characteristic phenotype, and we are actually very comfortable treating the patient for TB even without any evidence, but of course we always investigate these patients. Occlusive retinal periphlebitis, especially if it is accompanied by perivascular choroiditis lesions, it is very specific for TB, and tuberculomas, but of course you must distinguish sarcoid from TB. Both of them are causes of choroidal granulomas. Some of the common questions we ask in the history are family history of TB, any close contact with TB, and of course the socioeconomic status has a bearing. Any history of receiving anti-TB therapy in the past, not just for the eye, but also for systemic, any focus elsewhere in the body. HIV and TB, they form an important association, and of course, endemicity. So India is a highly endemic country, so is Middle East, and TB is emerging in many other countries, even developed countries, European countries. TB can be very much prevalent and endemic. The next step, of course, is when you have a patient of TB, apart from a thorough clinical examination, we always rely on fundus photography to document the fundus findings, because often we need to look at the level of the lesion, the activity of the lesion, and the location, pattern, and distribution. Fluorescein angiography, like we were discussing, becomes very important in uveitis because you need to look at the disease activity, leakage of the dye, as well as non-perfusion, for example, in patients of retinal vasculitis. Non-perfusion is an important feature of TB. Apart from, so occlusive retinal vasculitis is seen in very selected conditions. So TB is one of them. And of course, OCT to look at the choroidal involvement and granulomas, but not only that, also outer retinal involvement and differentiate retinitis from choroiditis. So the labs, now this is a lecture by itself, but in the labs, commonly we perform Montu test and the tuberculin skin test, and we have lots of literature on that, but usually, a positive Montu test would be regarded as corroborative investigation, and especially it gains relevance in patients who are not in endemic countries. So if you have an American patient coming, a positive skin test would be quite relevant in the examination. The QuantiFERON TB Gold, of course, the government of India has phased out or is not recommending it anymore. In many countries, QuantiFERON is not the investigation of choice. In Abu Dhabi, for example, we don't have Montu easily available, so we have to rely on QuantiFERON. So there are a number of geographic variations in this. But one thing which is certain is that chest X-ray, of course, if you don't have CT scan, then you go ahead with chest X-ray at least. But if you have a CT scan, then prefer a contrast-enhanced CT to look for any old evidence of TB. Molecular diagnostic tests can be performed, so if you don't have the facilities available, please refer the patient to a center where molecular diagnosis can be possible. It's not required in all cases, Very selected cases may require molecular diagnostic tools, and always investigate for any other etiology. So you must differentiate, at least sarcoid should be ruled out by your basic investigations, and we often perform syphilis and HIV testing in all our patients, as well as toxoplasmosis. Now, treatment in TB. So if you have an anterior uveitis, be sure always to dilate your patient. So when I say anterior uveitis, we are going with the understanding that the posterior segment has been dilated, examined properly. So of course, the treatment would be topical steroids and cycloplegics. And when will you start ATT? Now remember, in TB uveitis, there's no urgency to start TB treatment. The TB treatment would be started if you have a granulomatous anterior uveitis phenotype with two tests positive. So we generally take either MONTU, QuantiFERON, or chest imaging. Now this is as per the COT study, but of course you have to depend on the clinical scenario and the history, because the COTs did not consider previous exposure to TB, did not consider the previous treatment of TB. So you must always fit into your clinical, the appearance of the patient and the history. In recurrent cases, especially chronic anterior uveitis, and if you have tests positive for TB, definitely ATT has a role in preventing recurrences and also to reduce the severity. Serpiginous-like choroiditis, like we all discussed, most of the experts, they feel that it's a very specific feature of ocular TB. So if you have any test positive, then you would prefer to give these patients antitubercular treatment. But always be sure of the paradoxical worsening. Tuberculoma, of course, if you have one positive test, again, tuberculoma is very, very characteristic of TB. And vasculitis is something which can be either garden variety or TB. So if you have a patient of isolated retinal vasculitis, please at least ensure that you have a strong evidence of TB, because many of these patients could be idiopathic. Now the next step would be corticosteroids or immunosuppression. Really for the inflammation, corticosteroids or immunosuppression work very well. Now there are certain papers which suggest that ATT alone may be sufficient if the inflammation is mild. So if you have a foveal threatening lesion, or if you have paradoxical worsening, you may even consider immunosuppression. So the recommended treatment, so there are different guidelines, but generally the one that, this is by Dr. Vishali, she would follow four drugs for 2 months, followed by INH and rifampin for 7 months. It's very different in Abu Dhabi, for example, very different in different centers. So there is no recommendation by the COTS as far as the treatment is concerned as of now. Finally, monitoring the response. So paradoxical worsening between 3 to 8 weeks is one of the most feared complications of the therapy. And of course, you monitor by not just anterior segment evaluation, but also by fundus photography. Sometimes you may have to do repeat fluorescein and ICG. And when do you refer? So please refer the patient if you feel that the clinical presentation is atypical, you're not sure about the diagnosis, the patient is unresponsive, or if you have any other complications such as drug resistance or recurrence despite full course of ATT. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you very much. Dr. Mallika, your thoughts, please.
Yeah, all said and done, I think it's primarily a clinical diagnosis.
Yes.
And irrespective of whatever the Mantoux test or the this thing, you have to go very strongly with your clinical.
That's true. So the clinical phenotype is something that you really need to focus on, pattern recognition.
And even the course of the disease even also. And the drugs themselves can cause vision loss. So
yes.
You have to alert the patient that if you find a sudden drop in vision, it could be the drug and not the uveitis. So I've had patients who were on ATT before the uveitis, and they suddenly had a drop in vision, and then we had to stop, change the drugs, they improve again.
And one message is that if you're not sure about diagnosis, please don't start ATT, because then it leads to complete confusion. If the patient is not healing, we don't know if the patient is responding. Sometimes the patient is losing vision because of ethambutol, so we don't really know what's going on.
So good way is to do the color vision and certain things which are specific to ATT toxicity, so that we can distinguish whether it is the uveitis.
Yes. Yes.
Dr. Raja.
Presentation. Have you seen the flip side of over-diagnosis, over-treating? What caution would you like to advise everyone?
So often what happened was that we had patients who were over-diagnosed and over-treated. Now the challenge comes if they have a recurrence and it's an autoimmune disease, it's not really TB. then these patients can end up getting category 2 ATT drugs, and they used to get it in the past. Now that's very toxic treatment. So ultimately the patient is not harmed by the disease, but by the therapy itself. So I think it's very important, especially in phenotypes like intermediate uveitis, retinal vasculitis. These are not really core TB. They are often garden variety of autoimmune inflammation in the eye. So if you have such kind of phenotypes, be very sure before you start ATT.
In what setting would you recommend PCR?
PCR would be if you have a diagnostic challenge, or if you have, for example, continuous progression where its paradoxical worsening is ruled out, or drug resistance is a possibility. So really, we are relying very less now on PCR, because PCRs are non-specific. Most of them are in-house, not very reliable. So each lab has its different standards and criteria. So PCR really is not something that we go in every case. There is.
But it's not very well validated for ocular specimens. It's mainly for pulmonary.
Yes.
All in all, it comes down to clinical findings. I'm seeing all the investigations on either this side or that, either sensitivity being a problem or specificity being a problem.
Yes, that's true, sir.
Avinash, sir.
Yeah, I think the discussion, what is being happening, is on clinical phenotypes. I think that's where it all has to happen, because the last over 15 years, the pivot along with the discussion was that MANTU. And everything revolved around that MANTU, and the clinical phenotypes were totally ignored, other than granulomatous KPs, iris nodules, Busaka nodules, and then everything stopped after that. Nothing were conclusive about the posterior segment findings, because the insight into the posterior segment manifestations and the classical phenotypes lies there, which was not studied, not published, and not spoken about as much as what we do currently at this point of time. So the discussion primarily revolved on two aspects: the granulomatous KPs, iris nodules, Busaka nodules. Fantastic, you pass your exam, and then MANTU positivity. So then you have the reason why you have to subject the patient to anti-tuberculosis treatment. But much has evolved in the last 15 years, and again, the whole world keeps going around, and I'm glad that it is going towards the proper way of clinical diagnosis than a MANTU-based diagnosis.
True.
Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Dr. Anirudh. We'd like to welcome our next speaker, Dr. Mallika Goyal, who is a senior VR consultant in Hyderabad. She'll be speaking on uveitic emergencies preferred practice guidelines.
So I'll speak on uveitic emergencies, preferred practice patterns. So what is an uveitis emergency? Anything that threatens vision, or is becomes an emergency sometimes simply because of the intolerable pain as scleritis. And in these emergencies, there is insufficient time to complete investigations and decide about the treatment. It could be an isolated idiopathic condition, or it could be an association with systemic inflammatory disease, or it could be infective, which is very important to know right in the beginning, because the treatment would be different. So we have to depend on our own clinical judgment in a uveitic emergency, because there's not enough time for investigations. So this, how do you know that it is a uveitis causing a problem? If there is severe pain, redness, photophobia is very important compared to any other cause for pain. Photophobia is very diagnostic of uveitis. It could be floaters, associated floaters, blurred vision, circumcorneal injection. Pain can be even a severe headache. It can be referred to the entire face and over the entire area of trigeminal nerve. And it could be associated with secondary glaucoma. So we should not focus just on the IOP. The IOP could be secondary to uveitis. So to name these can be scleritis, necrotizing retinitis, Behçet's disease, endophthalmitis, VKH and sympathetic ophthalmia, any retinochoroiditis threatening or involving the macula, because that would affect the vision, and optic neuritis. So scleritis is particularly an emergency because of the severe intolerable pain. I have seen adults crying from severe pain, and it's more in the night. And the patient says, just get rid of the pain, I don't want vision. So that's the situation there. And there, in certain cases, there is a risk of perforation if it is a necrotizing scleritis, which could be with inflammation and a red eye, or it could be just a white eye. The treatment is with intravenous methylprednisolone, oral NSAIDs, which work very well, and topical steroids. And then add alternative immunosuppression, such as methotrexate. But we have to be very, very careful that it is not an infective scleritis. Like this girl, she had enterococcus, which was sensitive only to teicoplanin and vancomycin, and resolved with proper treatment. If you had given steroids in this case, it would be a disaster. So similarly, we have syphilitic cases and post-buckling or post-squint surgery infections, which require antibiotics, not steroids. So that we have to use our clinical judgment again. Posterior scleritis may have no redness, obvious signs except severe pain the patient may complain of, and fundus may look completely normal. So we can do a B scan and you see a very severe choroidal thickening. We can see retroscleral fluid and a T sign from widened optic nerve shadow. This gives the diagnosis. Again, start the patient on steroids as an emergency. So severe pain, normal looking fundus, normal eye, could be scleritis. This is a patient where we thought we were dealing with neuroretinitis in the right eye, but the patient had such severe pain and headache that he said, I don't want anything else except pain relief. And when we treated him with the anti-syphilis treatment, all this cleared, and we realized that it was not neuroretinitis, it was scleritis, because neuroretinitis does not cause pain. So posterior scleritis can look like neuroretinitis. But neuroretinitis would, so any case of retinitis or choroiditis where patient complains of severe pain, rethink the diagnosis. It may not be just retinitis, choroiditis, there may be associated scleritis. Because those are painless conditions, retinitis and choroiditis. ARN is again an emergency because it can cause retinal detachment as well as the fellow eye involvement. So if we treat as an emergency, we can prevent fellow eye involvement as well. And it can come as posterior involvement, like this case. So it should not take away from the diagnosis. There are cases where it start posteriorly also, instead of peripherally. And if a patient complains of sudden drop of vision in ARN, that is retinal detachment usually. So what is the treatment then if you suspect it strongly? Again, it's a primarily clinical diagnosis. Give intravenous acyclovir or oral val acyclovir can be given, which has a very good ocular bioavailability. And you may supplement it with intravitreal ganciclovir for faster action. PORN, not commonly seen, but seen in immunocompromised patients like advanced AIDS. This is again a viral disease and causes rapid blindness from macular and optic nerve involvement. Again, requires valacyclovir and intravitreal ganciclovir. CMV retinitis, semi-emergency, especially if it's involving the macula. Again, because it can cause retinal detachment, macular scar, and optic atrophy, give intravitreal ganciclovir. Or oral valganciclovir, which is not as effective as intravitreal ganciclovir. If there's a retinal detachment with CMV retinitis, if you can get away with a laser demarcation, that's best, because these detachments are very complex to operate. Endogenous endophthalmitis, Behçet's disease, because it can rapidly cause optic atrophy and severe extensive ischemia. So that's an indication for IV methylprednisolone. And two immunosuppressives, not one. Similarly, VKH disease requires IV methylprednisolone and other alternative immunosuppression. Sympathetic ophthalmia, exciting eye inflammation, or the other eye inflammation. These are the Dallin-Fuchs nodules, the hypopigmented fundus following a complex VR surgery in one eye. This is the fellow eye. CSR can also present as CSR. The sympathetic ophthalmia can present like CSR as in this case, but the FFA gave the diagnosis. And then any disease which is threatening the macula, any chorioretinitis, such as this patient, which is post-COVID bilateral, post-COVID vaccine bilateral choroiditis, which resolved on steroids, high-dose oral steroids. Toxoplasma requires urgent anti-toxoplasma treatment. Sometimes the toxo may resolve and then there is a vision drop. It could be from CNVM. So you can do an OCT and then give anti-VEGF. So these are the things which require immediate anti-TB treatment to reduce the macular scarring. So in summary, any sight-threatening uveitis is an emergency, requires prompt recognition of the specific disease from your clinical acumen, and differentiate infective from non-infective, and timely initiation can preserve vision. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Dr. Raja, your thoughts on this?
So the crux is what is already mentioned about it. So it's the when a patient presents with uveitis, so the first question is whether we have to start steroids or not. And second is, if you're not going to start steroids, what could be the possible etiological reason? And the third question is, if you're still not able to identify the etiological agent based on the patterns, do we have time to buy and treat appropriately? So that would be the questions which has to come in mind. The first one is whether to start steroids or not. Second is, if it is infective, does it have a pattern so that we identify etiological agent? And if it does not have a pattern, where is it located? Do we have, just on the premise that, do we have time to buy if it is far away from the center of the macula or involving the disc? So if we have these things into consideration, so it will ease the person and would help to examine the patient in a very objective way, so that the due diligence which has to be practiced when the patient with inflammation comes is being exercised.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
One thing I would like to add is very elaborate presentation. The emphasis was on emergencies related to the eye.
Correct.
Sometimes you can pick up systemic emergencies, and that needs to be kept in mind, that you know, sometimes while we are looking at the eye, there may be some systemic arthritis or vasculitis, or might sometimes masquerade, you know, there may be some other malignancy. Those also can be.
Yeah, like endogenous endophthalmitis, often they may be having other serious issues which we may be. But by and large, so in so many years, I have not found any patient where systemic was my problem and I just had to handle the eye. Because if it's a systemic thing, they generally won't come to us at all. They're already somewhere else, and the eye is the last priority at that time, generally.
We published that, you know, unlike the West, endogenous endophthalmitis in our country happens to be because of transient bacteremia than septicemia. So in the West, predominantly there are septicemic patients admitted, and the ophthalmologist gets a call for them to see. But
yeah,
here they walk into the clinic, so
yeah,
which is not the case in the West.
Yeah.
Kim, sir. Okay, thank you, sir.
In
thank
fact,
you,
in most of our endogenous endoph, we never find a focus at all, despite extensive screening and.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Now it's my proud privilege to invite the next speaker, Dr. Moona Bende. Again, our teacher, our guru at Shankar Netrale Chennai, senior VR consultant for many, many decades now, not years. And she will be talking on pars plana vitrectomy in uveitis, preferred practice guidelines. Dr. Moona Bende, please.
Thank you, Satyajit. And thanks, everyone, for staying on for this session. In the next few minutes, I'll share a few preferred practice patterns on vitrectomy in uveitis. The first question is, why sample the vitreous? Traditionally, the vitreous is acellular. So the presence of cells, inflammatory mediators, as you see in uveitis and neoplasia, you're more likely to get it from a vitreous sample. A vitreous sampling is good if you have eyes with posterior segment involvement. Usually we know the aqueous doesn't give us enough information or enough sample. We can get a much larger volume from the vitreous. And now with our new techniques, it's easier to perform the vitrectomy with MIBS. So you could have a diagnostic vitrectomy where you have uveitis of unknown etiology, whether we've been talking in the last two talks about the non-confirmatory lab test, so you may want to sample the vitreous, unresponsive uveitis, where you suspect infection or malignancy, masquerades are very common, and of course for obtaining a chorioretinal biopsy. Whereas vitrectomy can also be therapeutic when you have dense vitritis which precludes the retinal view, debulking of the vitreous, where you remove the infectious antigens and inflammatory mediators, also helps to control severe uveitis. Definitely, if you have retinal detachment, as in viral retinitis, along with complicated cataract surgery, one may want to do a vitreous debulking, and rarely if the cystoid macular edema is recalcitrant. And of course, for most of us, we are surgeons, the vitreoretinal complications of either vasculitic or non-vasculitic uveitis forms a very major chunk of our practice. What are the pre-op considerations? Always, most of the time when you do a vitrectomy, the patient is already on steroids. So if there is active inflammation, the steroid cover is preferable. But if you're suspecting a masquerade, then you need to stop the steroids. There are a little questionable duration of stopping. Maybe Avinash will help. Many studies say 2 weeks, some people say 4 weeks, stopping the steroids before you do the vitreous biopsy. And it's important to discuss with the patient the risks versus benefits of the procedure, because it's not always confirmatory that you're getting a proper yield. What are the challenges when you operate on a uveitic eye? The conjunctiva could be friable. Many times they have lots of deposteroid hanging around the place. And definitely you can have scleral thinning in cases with scleritis, where it may be difficult to close the sclerotomies later on. Band-shaped keratopathy is quite common in eyes with uveitis. You may need to remove it prior to surgery. Of course, you can have neovascularization of the anterior segment, which can cause troublesome bleeding, poor pupillary dilatation, cataract, and both pre- and post-op hypotony. Coming to the posterior segment itself, the vitreous can look amber-colored. The Schlieren, which we normally associate with rheumatogenous RD for people starting out, when you start doing a vitrectomy for a uveitic eye, you may see this golden glistening vitreous, and you think it's subretinal fluid. It's not. An inflamed eye, the vitreous can look like that. There can be thick past plano ciliary body membranes, not only inferiorly, but also 360 degrees, which can cause a drag when you make your sclerotomies. There could be abnormal vitreoretinal adhesions. The retina could be necrotic or edematous, so you have to be very careful when you induce a PVD. And if you have a sunset glow fundus due to lack of contrast, the laser uptake may be unpredictable. Needle aspiration is more or less obsolete now. Traditionally used to be done with a 26 gauge needle. Most of us don't prefer it, because you can always put a small gauge cutter and get it safer. How do you do a vitreous biopsy or a diagnostic vitrectomy? You try to get the cortical vitreous, because cellularity is more. You first take an undiluted sample. A desired amount is almost 1 to 2 ml, followed by a diluted sample. There are recent descriptions of under-air procedures. For those who are starting out early, be careful, because of the difference in properties of fluid and air, you can, if you do too much of air, you can have collapse of the globe. Valved cannulas are definitely preferable, especially when you're using undiluted samples. We can use a manual aspiration, which helps you to get more volume. Use a low cut rate with a high duty cycle. You can get a large chunk of vitreous, but the rates of complications are higher. So a high cut rate with a low suction is definitely preferable. And most times, if you want to study the cellular composition of the vitreous, we prefer a larger bore, such as the 23 compared to the 25 gauge. Once you've done this collection, switch on the infusion and collect the diluted sample. And later on, you can collect the sample from the cassette and subsequent washing from total vitrectomy. This is a short video on how we collect a vitreous sample. I'm sorry, I think it's playing there. It's not playing here. Yeah, okay, yeah. So basically, that's how we manually aspirate. And then you connect the tubings of the vitrectomy machine. And this is, And this is the method of doing the vitreous biopsy with air. You collect the sample from behind the air bubble. Then continue that after turning on the fluid infusion. And it's most important to label the sample and request appropriate tests, because tests cost a lot of money. So you ask for a PCR and then you have an RT-PCR, patient pays double. So make sure you know what you're asking for. Send the sample preferably within 30 minutes of acquisition. And this is more important. You send it in a mild cytofixative in a sterile syringe. And remember never to send in formaldehyde for cytology. So this is what you would want to look for. You have both pathology samples as well as microbiology samples. Speak to the lab and check exactly how they want to send it. I will finish in a minute or so. So like I mentioned, therapeutic vitrectomy helps to debulk the vitreous and decrease the inflammation. Also send a sample for microbiology and histopathology if you're doing a therapeutic vitrectomy. Remember the challenges that I mentioned earlier. And if you do vitrectomy for VR complications of uveitis, make sure you hike up the steroids if the patient is on maintenance dose. Remember the challenges that I mentioned. Most of these eyes, we require silicone oil, especially if there is viral retinitis and eyes with chronic hypotony. This is a patient who developed vitreous hemorrhage after a severe vasculitis, and this is the picture post surgery. Acute retinal necrosis, we've already, Malika has discussed, severe vitritis with large retinal breaks, and these eyes often require vitrectomies. CMV retinitis, the eye looks quiet. Postoperatively, it's important to continue immunosuppression, watch for variations in intraocular pressure, wide fluctuations are known. Continue ATT and antiviral treatment, don't forget to look at the other eye. Consider other eye surgery if patient is already on high dose of steroid and prolonged silicone oil tamponade in most cases. These are the complications specific to uveitic eyes. Hypotony is probably the most common of them all. And since this is a PPP session, I've referred to these guidelines, so you can use them as well. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Dr. Malika, please.
I was in and out so of the rooms. Did we mention endophthalmitis as one of the, I don't recall endophthalmitis as one of the indications for vitrectomy.
No, I didn't use endophthalmitis because it was a uveitis session. But then if there is a patient with chronic uveitis that you think is chronic uveitis not responding, then endophthalmitis and malignancy are two conditions that you would need to think of.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
So as a routine in any suspect case, supposing you're suspecting it could be lymphoma or something, what are the basic things you will ask the lab to do? Or would it be the entire slide which you had shown in every case?
No. If we are looking at lymphoma, if you're very strong suspicion,
yeah,
we do the MYDD88 mutation, we ask for it. And of course, the cytology. Then we won't. If we are not sure, then we would ask for everything.
And when you suspect some kind of infection, let's say it could be TB or anything, how do you go about the the nucleic acid analysis? Do you go for a PCR for all the organisms, or do you have a panel where you can test for all parasites, virus, fungus?
No, we have the fungal, the viral one, where they test for HSV, VZV, and CMV. And then if we want TB, we ask for it. We generally target it if we have a reasonable clinical suspicion.
So those are PCR, is it?
Yes, PCR, yes.
So do you have, would it also cover for toxoplasmosis? And
we generally ask for it specifically if we want. But I think they use more of ELISA for toxo rather than PCR.
Yeah, but ELISA is not as, may not be as sensitive, whereas sometimes PCR may pick it up, or not PCR, but some kind of nucleic acid amplification method would pick up toxo where your ELISA may be negative. Patients where I've sent samples for these commercially available panel of Exciton or similar iGenetix, and we do get a lot of positive results from them, which can change the treatment, completely change the treatment, especially in endophthalmitis cases or suspect endo. I had a case which was being treated as endoph, but actually turned out toxo based on Exciton report. And then when you gave the correct treatment for toxo, she resolved after 7 months.
Yeah, what we generally tend to do if we are not very sure and we are asking, like say I'm sending a sample for endophthalmitis, and then I tell them, now hold the sample for PCR.
Mm.
So if nothing grows, then use it. So
yeah,
you take a good enough sample, you can always call the lab and say, hold
yes
on, and use the sample for something later.
Yeah. For PCR, how do they store the sample for later? How do they store it?
I just give it to the lab and I tell them just keep it and
just
don't
just
do anything. Yeah,
all.
You just, they keep it, they refrigerate it and I just say keep it. So.
No, this is a basic question on the decision to operate on these patients, to, in a highly inflamed eye, to do a pars plana vitrectomy, any pre-instructions that you need to?
Yeah, it's very rare that we would operate on a highly inflamed eye unless we are looking for a diagnostic, as a diagnostic approach,
a diagnostic
more for diagnostic, probably sometimes as a therapeutic. I think sometimes in ARN, if it is just going on and you know there's retinal detachment behind, then possibly we would use on a highly inflamed, otherwise very rarely. Yes, definitely.
Thank you, ma'am. We'll move on to the next talk. I'd like to welcome Dr. Avinash Patange, Senior Vitreoretinal Consultant, who will be speaking on how different serpiginous choroiditis from serpiginous-like choroiditis preferred practice guidelines. Dr. Avinash, please.
Yeah, intentionally I've made my presentation very simple, not getting into the depths of uveitis, so that there's something which can take over into day-to-day practice. So the presentation will revolve around 8 questions. Now the first question is, how do we differentiate serpiginous from serpiginous-like choroiditis, right? So there are 3 points which we have to consider. That in serpiginous choroiditis, which is classical description from the West, before from the subcontinent serpiginous-like choroiditis came in, there are 3 important points which we have to consider. One is amount of inflammation in the vitreous and in the anterior chamber is more in patients with serpiginous-like choroidopathy, whereas it is literally absent in patients with serpiginous choroiditis. The classical does not have inflammation in the vitreous and the anterior chamber. So the second point is, it is centrifugal. The classical serpiginous starts from the disc and then it has a centrifugal spread, whereas serpiginous-like choroiditis does not start from the optic nerve head. It can start somewhere and then it has a centripetal progression. And third, especially when the regression starts happening, you'll see pigmentation of the margins of serpiginous-like choroiditis, serpiginous choroiditis, whereas in serpiginous-like, the hyperpigmentation is usually in the center. So that is again very classical of a TB-based serpiginous-like choroiditis in an endemic country like India. So those were the 3 basic differences. So absence of inflammation, centrifugal spread coming from the disc, and pigment clumping are the progression of the progressing margins. Now, the second question is, a serpiginous choroiditis or serpiginous-like choroiditis is a morphological diagnosis. Now, there is something in uveitis which we have to understand, morphological diagnosis, etiological diagnosis. So serpiginoid or serpiginous-like is a morphological diagnosis. Acute retinal necrosis is a morphological diagnosis. Why? Because there are many organisms which can cause a similar pattern. Now in serpiginous-like choroiditis in a country like ours, the major or the most common organism happens to be tuberculosis. So the discussion around serpiginous-like choroidopathy in subcontinent happens to be MTB. So the third question is, what are the morphological phenotypes? There are a couple more, but I'm going to present these 2 commonest ones, the dendritic ones, and the second is the placoid one. So the dendritic and the placoid are the 2 commonest presentation which you would get to see, and which is common amongst the 2, the dendritic is more common than the placoid variant, right? So I discussed 3 questions till now, how to differentiate serpiginous from serpiginous-like, and the second question was, asked the question whether it's a morphological diagnosis or it's an etiological diagnosis. It's a morphological diagnosis, not an etiological diagnosis. In subcontinent, TB is more common, and 2 common morphological variants, dendritic and placoid, dendritic more common than the placoid. The 4th question is, can it metamorphosize from multifocal, unifocal, or placoid choroidopathy? You know why I put this? Because TB can present in more than one ways. Again, being very relevant to our Indian subsetting. Now, here, if you heard Anirudh speaking about TB-associated lesions, which the classical phenotypes. The one what you can see here is, you can see this hyperpigmented spot in the left side photograph. It is right underneath the vessel. This is one of the classical signs where when you observe them, it makes you point towards, or your thought process goes towards tuberculosis. And I will also show you in this slide, when this patient has a choroiditis patch underneath the vessel, when it presents, and then it resolves, you can see the subvascular pigmentation happening. Such a big choroiditis patch, when it resolves, it forms this hyperpigmented lesions, which is called subvascular pigmentation, very characteristic clinical sign. But the point of relevance, what I'm going to make here is the unifocal choroiditis resolved. But few months later, this patient presents like a placoid type of serpiginous like choroidopathy. That's the point what I was trying to make. It can come from unifocal, it can come from multifocal, or a placoid itself can present in that particular variant. The fifth is, what are the causes for loss of vision? And this is something which we have to understand. In an acute setting and in delayed setting, the causes are way different. So in an acute setting, it is the progression towards the center of the fovea which is, has to be thought of, because we know that it has a centripetal spread. And fovea is something which has to be looked at a very in a very precise way, so that we don't lose out on time. If fovea gets affected, then the chance of him losing this 20/20 or 6/6 vision goes away. And the second is, if the patient presents months later with sudden decrease in vision, look out for small subretinal hemorrhages and in the fovea, subfoveal hemorrhages, because these patients are prone to develop neovascular membranes. So those are the two causes for decrease in vision. So can these patients present with nyctalopia? Yes, if there's an extensive spread across the choroid which is there, so these patients can have difficulty in dim illumination, so which you have to take it into consideration, and counseling has to be done in that particular way. We are talking about tuberculosis, we are talking about serpiginous like choroidopathy. This is one condition where anti-tuberculosis treatment goes hand in hand with corticosteroids. And why? Because the hypersensitivity reaction or autoimmune like response is classically seen in patients with serpiginous like choroidopathy. So there is no brainer in serpiginous like choroidopathy where there is no discussion which happens, I use only ATT, I don't use ATT, you have to couple both together. Now, having said that, when you have to do both together, right? So you have to understand the various ways by which steroids can be administered in this patients, oral or intravenous in the form of methylprednisolone when it's very close to the fovea. Then you have the local periocular or even intravitreal form which can be there. And last, the eighth question is there a pattern of healing? Yes. For sake of understanding, autofluorescence is a very simple non-invasive investigation. In an active setting, you will see hyper-autofluorescent in its various intensities. But when it resolves, it becomes hypo-autofluorescent. That's a good way to understand for a beginning level. So the margins will be hyper-autofluorescent, but later on when it resolves completely, it becomes hypo-autofluorescent. So those are the 8 points which people can take back into the practice. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Avinash. Dr. Mallika, your thoughts, please.
Yeah, so when you said that it's serpiginoid, are you also saying that then those cases should receive ATT, or is it
serpiginoid?
Yes. Are you, when you diagnose a morphological diagnosis of serpiginoid, are you also saying it is synonymous with giving antitubercular treatment?
Yes, I do antitubercular treatment with corticosteroids.
Yeah, that's right. But it's just a given. If you made a morphological diagnosis, it's a given that you will give ATT.
Yes. So,
Dr. Kim.
Would you even do mantles, or you would not even bother to do those tests?
I'll do for the sake of completion. Yeah, for sake of completion, I'll get it done. But if it's negative also, the clinical diagnosis is good for me to start the treatment and suggest my pulmonologist to start right away.
That's the problem. So when we do these tests, if it's negative, how do you ignore that negative test? And that's the other side I asked Ganero, that maybe some cases we are over-diagnosing and say MAN2 is positive and something else. So I think it's more of a clinical diagnosis.
Thank you very much. That brings us to the end of this session. I would like to thank the expert panel, Dr. Mallika, Dr. Kim sir, Dr. Raja. I'd like to thank the senior consultants, Dr. Pramod Bende sir, Dr. Muna Bende ma'am, Dr. Avinash, for giving their time and giving their expertise. Thank you so much to all the participants over here. Thank you so much. Can I request all the expert panel and senior consultants to please come for a group picture here?